Camera's live.
We got the video on cut.
And you're tuned in to 99. You're not tuned in to 99. Where are we? What station? We are on so many stations.
We've got to talk about that. Yeah. But anyway, 12:30 a.m.
Thank you.
In the morning?
It's actually 11:30. And we're back on Nevada Real Estate Radio. Thanks for tuning into our show today. We're talking with real estate investors all across the state of Nevada and beyond. It used to be a couple of years ago that the way people were going to make a lot of equity growth in their real estate purchase was by purchasing a primary residence. The challenges since then, however, have been actually kind of positive challenges in the sense that values have gone up. So the opportunity to buy homes at the very, very bottom, do a quick flip and repair, they're all but gone in most areas. Nowadays, people have to look at other ways to make cash flow work for them when they buy investment properties. In the studio today, I have two experts that help us decipher the ways that you can continue to make money on real estate as an investment all across Nevada and beyond. Ron Bell is with us, and Ron is the president of the Reno Real Estate Investors Club. He's also a realtor, broker salesperson at Coldwell Banker Select in Northern Nevada. And Sherry Hill is with us too. Sherry is the wealth protection diva at Sage International. Sherry, talk to our listeners about wealth protection diva. How'd you earn that?
Many years, let me tell you. I actually earned the right to call myself the wealth protection diva because I am out there on the front lines with education. So really helping people understand the value of building a stream of income called real estate investing. And then more important, how do you protect those streams of income? How do you protect that wealth, those assets against creditors and all these other people that as soon as you make a lot of money, who wants it? Everybody else.
You know, real estate is an interesting thing to invest in because when you invest in things like art or you invest in stamps, you know, it's a very private thing. You buy them, you look at them, you put them in a safety deposit box, you hide the key, no one knows. But when you buy real estate, you're beating a big drum, aren't you? Because
yes.
It's on all the records, you got all these people involved. No wonder that, you know, when people have real estate, Sherry, they're actually vulnerable, more vulnerable than they were before. It must be worthwhile to do it is all I can figure.
Well, that's true, because now if I'm an investor and I'm putting tenants in that property, now I'm not just responsible for the land and the building, I'm also responsible for everything going on inside that home. And people think, well, I have insurance and I'm okay, but guess what? Insurance doesn't cover everything. And, you know, we see it every day. It's like, I was in, years ago, in small claims court and watched this whole case because this young couple had a dog and the dog ran out and killed a little pony that lived next, I won't even get into it all.
But another dog-related incident.
Incident. And again, where did it all originate? The home they were living in.
So the real estate, although it gives you great benefits, and we all know that cash flow is awesome and equity growth is awesome, there are things that, you know, put you more on the edge, put you more in the spotlight. So, if somebody has, let's say, two properties or three properties, and let's say Joe Smith owes him, you know, under his own name, he just rents them out, he's got tenants in there, what are some of the challenges that Joe Smith could have if an occurrence happens at one of those rentals?
Well, first and foremost, you know, slip and falls, there's defects on the property, there's, you know, liens, there's all kinds of things that can happen. But most important is now, if he owns all those properties in his personal name, all those properties are up for grabs. And the premise of asset protection is to separate those assets, mm-hmm. right? So that not all our eggs are in one basket. Because if he's a successful real estate investor, mm-hmm. I'm guessing he has other streams of income. He may own a business, he may have other types of investments. So we have to look at everything to make sure that if there's an incident or a problem with one, they don't get to walk through and take everything he owns.
So you're saying that if he has a tenant renting one of his houses, and for whatever reason, terrible things happen in this world, but let's say there's a shooting on that premise between his tenant, who's paying his rent on time, and a visitor or an intruder, and there are shots fired and somebody gets seriously injured or dies, I mean, isn't the liability going to stay and the issue going to stay between the tenant and that individual?
Possibly. However, everyone gets named in the lawsuit. So they're going to go, well, was this guy negligent by placing that tenant in the property because this guy had a record a mile long and you didn't do a background check, you didn't do a credit check. So were you negligent, Mr. Landlord, by not ensuring that the guy you placed next door to me is a good citizen?
All right, so let's say that somebody gets a lawyer and they do find an accusation that the landlord was negligent by letting this ex-felon, let's say, or somebody with a criminal record, rent his house. If he's not protected, you're saying that the other properties that he owns could be subject to some kind of a payout, right?
Well, I don't know of any lawsuit that settles for less than hundreds of thousands of dollars. So where's he going to come up with it? And of course, insurance is the second line of defense after your entity. The third line of defense is making sure that all your other assets are held not in your personal name. And of course, also being, you know, cognizant and non-negligent and doing all your due diligence and those things. But again, no lawsuit settles for less than hundreds of thousands of dollars. And that's just the financial toll. Let's move into the emotional toll. Let's move into the time toll. Let's move into all the other factors that suck up your entire life to get through this one event that possibly you may have been able to avoid or eliminate or not take it as far as it had to go.
You know, at the last Reno Real Estate Investors Club that I attended, Sherry, you were there. Ron Bell's with us in the studio too. Ron, you remember, she made a presentation on the Series LLC. And Ron, you suggested that. Had you had some exposure to that kind of structuring in the past, or have you heard about that before?
Absolutely. A lot of our investors at the club, and I recommended Series LLC to a lot of the investors, and you know, I turned a lot of my own clients on to the Series LLC idea, especially some of these expensive seminars. You know, you see it all the time, the county tax roll, you know, 123 Main Street, LLC, 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 which is fine, but they're paying for each individual one. They don't have the master one in the series underneath. So luckily I saw Sherry in the crowd, and one of our speakers didn't show up, and I didn't want it to be the Ron Bell show, so I said, Sherry, can you show up? And she just on the cuff went there and told us about Series LLC in a very eloquent and simple way to understand it, and well, that is on my YouTube channel, and so if somebody wanted to look at it, they, you know, but it was a great little example of how to do it.
I was fascinated by that too, Sherry, because to me it made it pretty simple the way you make things happen, in the sense that you separate the properties. The same investor that we're talking about, Joe Smith, with three properties, if he was in a Series LLC and he had problems with one of his properties, it's really shielded from the other two for the most part. I mean, it's a whole different deal.
It's a great tool in the toolbox, and fortunately we have it in the state of Nevada. So when it makes sense for that particular investor to use, then of course we're going to use it. And as Ron mentioned, the real benefit is that you're moving away from one property and a separate LLC, which can get very costly on an annual basis. You're looking at tax returns, all those things, and it's a great way to reduce that down into one. Mm-hmm. However, they are more complicated. Most people don't understand how to use them effectively, and so it's really important that you consult with someone to make sure that it's the right tool for you based on the type of real estate that you're investing in, and if you can use it, why not?
You know, to be a good real estate investor, you have to be a good student, I think, because you're always out to learn new things, because things are always changing in the industry. And Sherry, you probably run into a lot of great students because you're a great teacher as well. I know you have some teaching classes that you do throughout the year with the university. Let our listeners know about that.
All right. So obviously I do a lot of speaking and teaching through Sage International, but I also, through the Nevada Small Business Development Center, teach the Next Level for Entrepreneurs class. This will be my eighth year in teaching it. It's a ton of fun, and it's really based around noodling out this idea, you know, that you have. Will it be viable and profitable if you can convert it into a business? Or if you're someone already in business, it's a great way to really look at, are you still relevant? Are you tapping into everything you should be? Do you need to change directions? And so it's just really an awesome process to, I call the magic in the process, of really working on your business. And that's huge for business owners. They don't often do that.
Yes. And as a real estate investor, unlike many business owners, you don't have a lot of associates, right? You don't have people to bounce things off. Other businesses that I've worked in where I've been in management, I could call in the department heads. And myself and six or seven people would talk about how we're running this business and the things that we're going to do. When you're a real estate investor, you maybe have one other person. Maybe it's your loved one, your spouse. Maybe you have a partner. But most people that I run into, Sherry, it's one individual who's in charge of that business. And as such, many people don't have anybody to be accountable to, somebody to consult with. How do you come into play in that situation?
Well, that's why I'm, you know, a huge proponent of the Real Estate Investor Club as one up here in the north, and certainly they're all over the country, because who's in the room? You have seasoned investors, you have newbie investors, you have people in the middle. And so it's that common collective of intelligence that's going to help you be a better decision maker on the business side as well. I mean, if you don't have somebody challenging you and looking at it from a 30,000 foot aerial view without all the emotion attached to it, how do you really work on your business?
Mm-hmm.
So it takes people, it takes mentors or helpers, and so if you're all alone out there, there are opportunities.
You're an outstanding opportunity, in fact, Sherry, for anybody to learn more about real estate investing, whether you're just starting or whether you've been in the business for years. A lot of our listeners, Sherry, like to send a text to us so that they can ask their questions. Why don't you give us the best number to send a text to you? Give us your cell phone number.
I'm not giving my cell phone number. I'll give you my phone number, 775-786-5515, or you can call toll-free, 800-254-5779.
Not up to the new technology, are we?
Not down with texting.
Not down with texting yet. Ron Bell is with us in the studio as well. Ron, I know you've got a big meeting coming up here in December at the Reno Real Estate Investors Club. I want to talk to you about what that's going to look like, plus talk a little bit more about that new company that's going to be building some batteries or two in Nevada. That's Tesla. So please hang on, and we'll be back after this message.
I cannot believe you better make me give out my cell number.
Hey, it's impromptu.
Cell number.